Hey, so we're gonna venture into an interesting topic this morning. I was thinking, where the hell? Sometimes some topics are scary. Some topics are like, holy shit, what am I doing going here? But I thought to talk about love this morning. This is what was up. And this is what came. So here we go. What do we know about love? What do we know about love? There's so many stories. We were brought up on such, unending stories about love, and the idea of love and romantic love mostly. We were brought up on stories of romantic love. And country and Western stories about, love that was not responded to, and and heartbreak stories, and somebody done somebody wrong stories, and so love. What do we know about love? What, from our perspective of the dualistic world, love really doesn't exist. Love is a conditional agreement. Love is an emotional thing, emotional love. And many of us have ventured in, felt the emotional discomfort of a love that didn't go the way we thought it would go, and then, said, that's enough of that, and many of us have said that's enough of that because we were still looking for something. So love isn't about getting something, and that's, I guess, where I've come to with the topic. Love is about being. We are love. So we love isn't a something we can produce. We are love. When we look at the depths of it, there is no where love isn't. I remember when in my early search for God, being in a church basement in a big book study, and there was a sign on the wall. It was a United Church basement because that's where alcoholics end up, is in church basements. And the sign said, God is love. And I was like, wow. Okay, I can get that. I believe in love. I have some knowledge of love. I understood that, at as much as they could, that my mom and dad loved me, and that, I understood that I loved my kids, and I understood that, I could see that, I had loved pets, a dog, I felt love of some sort in some of the relationships I'd been in. Often, though, it was a love-fear situation. I was sometimes hard for me to be open. Hi, Terry Lynn. In love, hard for me to be open in love when I was afraid, to be be rejected or have, because from the ego there's always this fear around love, so as we lift up into the higher realms of, it's easier for us to just give without expectation. But I remember when I did the relationship piece of my fifth step, and I have, I recognized that I have never, in the world of the dualistic world, in the world of my persona, given love without expectation. In a relationship, I was always trying to get something. I was trying to get approval. I was trying to get, I was trying to get love from somebody else. And, you know, so I'd always been at one level a taker, not a giver in the world that I came from, and living in fear. So love, yes, yes, you know, so to be able to give without expectation, to just to allow love, you know, to just be love is the possibility unconditionally, you know, to not need anything. And this is the state that we can find ourselves in as we awaken to who we are. We are love. It's I don't find it easy again to talk about. Talking about love is like talking about God, and you know, and where is love not? Where is God not? You know, at this, you know, stage of my life or awakening, I see God in everything and love in everything, and it's amazing, you know. And from my mind, though, and it's still there, that comes up with, you know, judging or in right or wrong or good or bad. It hasn't, you know, for those of you who, you know, are watching who have had awakening experiences, and you think, why do I, you know, I know at one level that love is everything, that God is everything, and yet still fall into, you know, sometimes judging or sometimes complaining or sometimes being in fear, recognize that that will go on. That can happen, you know, but if we give it no attention, if we let it go, you know, I mean, a lot of my life, when somebody paid a little attention to me, I would think, well, what does she want? You know, which really was a reflection of me in my wanting, you know, and to have moved out of that, and to recognize that, you know, when I have a friend or I spend time with somebody, it doesn't matter, you know, if she has a wanting or she needs something or he needs something, you know, what matters is, am I there in love? Am I there to share my heart and to give the most that I can, you know, where the opening is to give? Anyway, a little story about love. Maybe we'll talk more about that over the next little bit, because I think that it's a, you know, we've been sold a lot of stories about love, you know, and many of us have ended up in a lifelong victim story around love or around relationship, you know, and maybe we could let go of even the whole concept or idea of relationship and look at every connection as a relating, not a relationship, because a relationship speaks of time. You know, it talks about time. It's a relationship. It's an agreement. It's a contract. You know, what about a relating that's unconditional, that doesn't have rules, that we're in because that's where we want to be. That's where we feel drawn to be in each moment. And so often we've created rules because of the a fear of you know, a feeling. We didn't want to feel, so we create these rules a relating is about now. A relationship is about time, past and future. So there is no such thing as a relationship. Play with that. Okay, we're talking about recovery. And let's go into, what day is it now? Oh my gosh, it's November the 30th. Tomorrow, December the 1st, I'll have been in recovery for 40 years. Tomorrow, December the 1st, it'll be 40 years. Not that time matters. And I guess when we bring up time, it's, you know, in one way to show that this thing works, you know, that I was a hopeless case. I really was. And in so many ways. I was so, you know, as a practicing alcoholic addict, I was a hopeless case, thank you, and to just, you know, the amazing life that I've had, even sometimes, you know, only receiving a very small, hey Troy, only receiving a very small part of the gift sometimes, you know, only being able to take in so much of it, still living often in fear, even in recovery, and so lots of the years were troubled years, but, hey Terry Lynn, nice, 176 days, yes, you know, it just gets better, it does stay, you know, on the path. Love does exist, yes, of course it exists, but it isn't something we get, Troy, it's something that we have, it's something that we are, something that we share, you know, and of course it exists. But our concept of love often has been that it's, you know, has something to do with somebody else. And, we can share it. And sometimes people can share it with us, you know. We can feel it together. But, you know, we slip into that bliss together of the one, which is amazing. And it ebbs and flows. That feeling of when we're with somebody and we let go of expectations, let go of the conditions on it. If you loved me, you wouldn't have done that. If you loved me, you would have been home for supper on time. You know, I mean, sometimes it's so ridiculous. So we just let it go. And you know, if we truly love somebody, it's regardless of what they do. It really is. It's not about anything. It's about truly loving somebody, and how they live their life is not our business. We just love them, and imagine living in an unconditional love with somebody. It's beautiful, and not expecting anything, not measuring. I did this; they should do that. Not measuring. Okay, here we go, you guys. We're going to read from November 30th, Thought for the Day. It says, we have slips in AA. It has been said, these are not slips, but premeditated drunks, because we have to think about taking a drink before we actually take one. The thought always comes before the act. It has been suggested that a man should always get in touch with another person in recovery before taking that first drink. The failure to do so makes it probable that they had decided to take the drink anyway. And yet the thoughts that come before taking the first drink are often largely subconscious. Hey, Jason. Hey, buddy. Nancy. Largely subconscious. The man usually doesn't know consciously what made him do it. Therefore, the common practice is to call these things slips. Am I on guard against wrong thinking? So, you know, as I've been in recovery a long time, we have all kinds of slips. I have emotional slips. You know, I can slip into anger or fear, you know, and as we become more aware or more conscious, we're less likely to go into those places. And if we're spiritually fit, which means, you know, if we're practicing, for me, sharing and helping others is part of my spiritual fitness. Prayer and meditation is part of my spiritual fitness. Gratitude is part of my spiritual fitness. If we're practicing and keeping spiritually fit, then we're less likely to have emotional slips, to fall into self-pity, self-centered fear, you know, which come generally way before we start to use substance to drink or to... hi, Scott. you know, so the thought of, you know, we get, as we in recovery for a while, we start to recognize the pattern. Aloha. Hi, Diana. Yeah. Okay, let me finish reading this. So we just read, this is from the 24-hour day book I read here on a daily basis. And we read the thought for the day, now the meditation for the day from this little book. This little book was written in 1954. I know it's an old one. It's a little patriarchal. Sometimes it's even a little racist. It's like, oh my God, I can't believe you wrote that. But it was at the time, and I edit as I go sometimes. The eternal God is thy refuge. He is a sanctuary, a refuge from the cares of life. You can get away from the misunderstanding of others. You can get away from the misunderstanding of others by retiring into your own place of meditation. But from yourself, from your sense of failure, your weakness, your shortcomings, whither can you flee? Only to the eternal God, your refuge, until the immensity of his spirit envelops your spirit and it loses its smallness and weakness and becomes in harmony again with his. Beautiful, beautiful. You know, practicing, you know, like spiritual practices, and we move into that oneness that I've been speaking of. You know, he speaks of it in this meditation today really nicely. You know, we can, says that if others, you know, are small thinking, we can move away from them through meditation and helping others. But beautiful what he just said, beautiful. Get this little book. Prayer for the day. I pray that I may lose my limitations in the immensity of God's love. I pray that my spirit may be in harmony with his spirit. Sweet. Sweet. So what we've been doing is we've been doing a little chat like this morning, which we did about love. My gosh, what a deep subject that is. And then we've been having a little meditation. We do the reading and then a meditation. So we're going to do like a 10-minute meditation. I've just started doing this a month or so ago with the meditation added. And just really to, it's a beautiful place for me to do a meditation, but it's also an opportunity for you to take a few minutes and just have a bit of a guided, you know, which only usually 6 or 7 minutes that we sit together. Sometimes a little less, sometimes a little more, but and we're just going to sit. So find yourself a comfortable spot and a comfortable spot to sit and meditate. And what happens, you know, people say to me, how do I meditate? Well, start with sitting. You know, it's like, how do you fall asleep? Start with laying down, you know, and closing your eyes. But we don't want to fall asleep when we're meditating. We just want to sit, close our eyes. That's right. And we can, our breath can bring us into the moment. So through the nose, we bring our attention to our breath. And whether we know it or not, as we focus on the breath, we come into this moment. My mantra, of course, is be here now, be here now. And this is how we get to be here now, using the breath. We can also bring our attention to our body. Just come into your body, feel your butt sitting on whatever you're sitting on. Feel your legs and your feet on the floor, if that's where they are. Just be in your body, and in your belly, in your chest, in your back, in your shoulders. Your shoulders just drop. Back to the breath. Breathe in. Breathe out. Just relax your neck, your jaw. Okay, we're just totally in their body here in this moment, in our breath. Nothing to imagine. Just be here. Let go of all your thoughts for just a moment. Let go of thinking of what's up for today, or you know, about anybody else. Where is she or where is he right now? Just let it all go. Nothing missing, nothing right, nothing wrong, nothing good, nothing bad. Just now, perfect in this second. Complete. You are, we are all complete. We are all one and complete in this moment. Connected as one. No matter where you are. Okay. Now when you're in this space, just if thoughts come in, just let them go. You don't have to fight them or chase them away, just let them go by. The thought has no energy of its own, it only has the energy we give it. So practice not giving it any energy, just let it go. Beautiful. just come back when you're ready. So, just one thought about love. In our prayer, just ask to be shown, to be guided in love, in being love. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. Love you guys. And we are love. We are.